one thing I want to get into, and you mentioned early, very early on in the introduction, was, and I think we're getting there, is diet composition and the question of if, well, there's good evidence. Yes, eating vegetables and fruits is good for health. And why is that? And the emerging evidence that has kind of turned the load up on antioxidant idea on its head. So during evolution, it was we're omnivores, and the same would be true with other animals that are omnivores or herbivores. It is advantageous to be able to eat plant materials, fruits, nuts, roots, leaves, because they have energy. And however, it's not necessarily advantageous to the plants that we eat them. In fact, it's generally not. And we know that in the case of insects, but it's also true with herbivores and so on. So most plants, the most vital parts of the plants in terms of propagation of the species, if you were to eat those, they have a bitter taste. The skin, so for example, the skin of grapes or apples, and, you know, broccoli, seed producing part of the broccoli and so on, they have a bitter taste. And so the thinking is that it was to our advantage to be able to eat these, even though they have a bitter taste and have these naturally occurring pesticides, is what they are. The plants are producing their own pesticides. So that's, in fact, one of the reasons plants produce so many of the chemicals is that many of those chemicals, their function is to dissuade insects and other organisms from eating them. That's their main function. Okay, so we co-evolved with these plants. And as we co-evolved with them, we evolved several ways to protect ourselves from overdosing on these pesticides that the plants normally produce. So one way is a bitter taste. The second way is vomiting. The third way, which is interesting from human environmental health standpoint, is we have evolved enzymes in our liver that rapidly remove these potentially toxic chemicals when we eat them. They're called cytochrome P450s. Okay, but the fourth way is that the individual cells in our body have evolved to respond to some of these chemicals by, for example, enhancing their antioxidant defenses or enhancing their ability to even extrude the chemicals. So I'll give you a few specific examples. I mentioned broccoli. Many of your viewers probably, if they're into health, they've probably heard of sulforaphane, which is a chemical that's in broccoli, and there's quite a bit of evidence that it can be good for health. And one of the ways it is it activates antioxidant defenses in our cells. So it's similar to exercise and fasting, which are stressors. The stress of this chemical that's in the broccoli that we consume, the stressor is the chemical. It's activating antioxidant defenses. Another example is curcumin, which is in turmeric root, which in Indian food is very common. And it also activates antioxidant defenses. The most commonly consumed plant toxin by your viewers, very likely, is caffeine. So if you were to take powdered, if you were to take concentrated caffeine and put it on your tongue, it has an extremely bitter taste. It's possible to overdose and die from caffeine, and there have been some documented cases of actually people essentially eating caffeine powder. If you take tea leaves, coffee beans, even ground coffee beans, put them on your kitchen table in the summer, assuming you don't have an ant-free house, and there's ants crawling on the table, you will notice that they avoid the coffee and tea leaves. And they're avoiding caffeine and other naturally occurring good toxins in them. So that contrasts with sugar or whatever, you know, any a lot of other highly palatable, addictive foods. So anyway, I was invited to write an article for Scientific American on this general notion that the reason fruits and vegetables are good for our health is not because there are free radical scavenging things like vitamin E or C can help in certain ways getting rid of free radicals. That's not the answer. The answer isn't that we want to swamp ourselves with things that sop up free radicals, because actually free radicals are important in our cells for normal signaling and in our adaptive responses to stress. Instead, the chemicals that are good for health seem to be acting by triggering mild adaptive stress responses in our cells that are in many, that overlap quite a bit with exercise and fasting. And these chemicals, again, they're concentrated in the exposed parts of the fruits, like the skin of the fruits. Here's a really interesting thing, green tomatoes. So bugs usually don't eat the tomatoes till they start to turn red in the garden. Okay, so why is that? The reason is they like the taste of the red ones better than the green ones. So it turns out there's this chemical that's been called tomatidine that's highly concentrated in the green tomatoes, and then levels of tomatidine decline dramatically as the tomato turns red. Okay, by the time the tomato starts turning red, the seeds in the tomato that have the potential to give rise to another tomato plant and propagate the species, they're ready to go. So if, I guess mainly this applies to birds, but so say a bird, birds won't eat green tomatoes either, so let's go with that. So the bird eats the red tomato, and they may eat some of the seeds. The seeds can resist going through their digestive system. Then they poop out the seeds, and the seeds can grow. You know, and they may poop out the seeds, you know, whatever, half a mile away. So now the tomato plants are, and that's, you know, so these are all evolutionary mechanisms that give advantages to one or both of the species during their coevolution.
Is there, can you, if a person is exercising regularly and also doing some form of intermittent fasting, and they're getting these activation of some of these stress response pathways and the beneficial effects, and you're getting the metabolic switching, and is there any need to also take in these plant phytochemicals that are also activating, you know, perhaps the same or different or both, you know, stress response pathways? In other words, like, can you just say, well, I don't need the to eat the plant compounds because I'm exercising and I'm doing intermittent fasting?
I wouldn't do that or say that. What hasn't been done though, Rhonda, is there, and the reason is it's expensive. There haven't been studies where within a study they do all these various combinations, you know, of, okay, we're going to do this study with, we'll have some people intermittent fast, we'll have some exercise, we'll have some do both, we'll have some, whatever, take in sulforaphane, or, and then we'll have them do sulforaphane plus intermittent fasting, and so on and so on. And my view on diet composition is one that I think makes sense from data from epidemiological studies, the blue zone, where, you know, there's certain places where people have exceptional longevity, and all of them have diets that are mostly plant-based. And then the evidence that simple sugar is bad for health is overwhelming. The saturated fat, I think the evidence is pretty strong. It's better to eat fish than red meat. And so, when, you know, complex carbohydrates are better than simple. I think that, you know, people shouldn't say, well, I can just eat at McDonald's every day if I exercise and intermittent fast, because it's, they would be better off than having been intermittent fasting and exercising, you know, if they're going to eat at McDonald's and don't want to give that up, then exercise and intermittent fasting will counteract that somewhat, but it's still kind of stupid.
The way I also think about it is, you know, you have something like sulforaphane, which we've talked quite a bit about on the podcast.
I know Jed, he's at Hopkins.
Yeah, he's a good friend of mine. And so, you know, you have something like sulforaphane that's activating the NRF2 pathway, which has, you know, all these downstream effects on phase two detoxification enzymes, you know, activating those and inhibiting the phase one biotransformation enzymes, which are involved in potentially making a pro-carcinogen, an actual carcinogen, you know, and all these, there's all these pathways that, you know, I don't know how much exercise and or intermittent fasting, you know, activates those pathways, I'm sure to some degree. But, you know, it seems as though different types of stressors do have a more robust effect on certain types of stress response pathways.
Yes.
And so why wouldn't you want to diversify?
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah. So, although I should say that, so go back to sulforaphane and NRF2 ARE pathway. That is activated by exercise and fasting. And so I would say these chemicals that are in the plants are more targeted in what they do. Compared to exercise and fasting, those chemicals affect the more limited number of pathways. In other words, you can't just take sulforaphane and it's going to substitute for exercise or intermittent fasting.